Can you cover this broken chessboard with 2x1 dominoes? Can you add or subtract the numbers from 1 through 6 to get 0? Can you swap the numbers into order using an odd number of swaps? These problems all look different from first glance, but they have one major thing in common. They can be solved with invariants. So, what is an invariant? Given a process, an invariant is something that does not change through every step of it. It's easiest to explain what that actually means with an example. Suppose we start with the numbers 1 through 6 on a chalkboard, and then begin a process such that, every minute, we erase two numbers and replace them with their product, until there's only one number left. Then, an example of an invariant in this process would be the total product of all the numbers on the chalkboard. Throughout the entire process, after each minute, the total product stays the same. So when the process ends with just one number left, it has to be the product of all the original elements, which is 720. Now that that simple example is done, let's go back to solve the problems from the beginning of this video. First, the broken chessboard problem from the beginning of the video. If you try tiling the chessboard a couple of times, it feels impossible. Like somehow there's this invisible force stopping you. And the answer is no. But how can we prove this with invariants? Consider the covering process. The process of placing down dominoes one by one until we can't anymore. Then, the relevant invariant is that there are always two more uncovered white squares than uncovered black squares. At the beginning, there are 32 white squares and 30 black squares, so there are two more white squares than black squares. Then, at every step of the process, every time we place down a domino, we always cover exactly one black square and one white square. So this difference is still 2. So, no matter how many dominoes we place, we'll always be stuck with 2 extra white squares that we can never fill in. And that's the entire argument! Note that the sole reason this works is because to place down a domino, you always have to cover exactly one black square and one white square. And that's because the chessboard coloring is special in this way. So, if I wanted to make the problem harder, I could erase the fact that the board is a checkerboard, so then the solver would have to both find the invariant argument and find the checkerboard coloring as well. That's all I had to say for this problem, so let's head to the next one. The second problem asked if we could somehow add or subtract the numbers from 1 through 6 in order to end up with 0. If you try it for a bit, like the first problem, the answer seems to be no. But how can we prove this with invariants? It doesn't seem like there's a process we can use. But there is, if we are a little creative. The idea is that we start with the expression plus 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5 plus 6 equals 21, and then we can transform this into any other expression by changing the corresponding plus signs into minus signs. To be more concrete, let's say we wanted to prove a specific expression, say minus 1 plus 2 plus 3 minus 4 plus 5 minus 6 can't equal 0. Then consider the process that begins with plus 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5 plus 6 and ends with that expression, with the steps in the process in between being flipping an individual plus sign into a minus sign. Then, the key invariant during this process is that the resulting expression after each step, after each sign flip, must still be odd. This is true because going from plus n to minus n causes a change of minus 2n in the expression, which is an even number. So since before the step, originally, the expression evaluation is odd, after the step, subtracting an even number, we end up with an odd number again. Thus, at the end of the process, the value of the final expression must be odd, and therefore can't be 0. This logic works for whatever expression we want to make, so that completes the problem. That was a little overkill for this problem, but one of the key ideas I wanted to highlight is that we can sometimes turn seemingly non-process problems into process problems in this fashion. If a problem wants us to cover all possible configurations, we can start at one specific configuration and then slowly convert it to every single possible other configuration through some specifically constructed process. Next is the third problem, asking if it is possible to swap the numbers in the list 43152 into order 12345 using an odd number of swaps. And again, if you try this yourself, the answer seems to be no, it's impossible. But how can we prove this? Of course, we use an invariant. But first, we need to define what an inversion is. An inversion in a list of numbers is a pair of numbers A and B, such that B comes before A in the list, yet B is greater than A. In other words, if the list was in order, A should be in front of B, as A is less than B, but instead, B happens to be before A. For example, with 4, 3, 1, 5, 2, 4 and 1 are an inversion, since 4 is more than 1, yet 4 appears before 1. The other inversions are 4 and 3, 4 and 2, 3 and 1, 3 and 2, and 5 and 2. So there are 6 total inversions. One special quantity is the total number of inversions in a list, which we'll denote by n. The key property it has is that after any swap between two numbers in a list, the total number of inversions changes by an odd number. So, how can we prove this? Well, first, let's prove it for the simple case, where the two numbers we are swapping are adjacent. Let the two relevant numbers be A and B, and then consider which pairs flip their inversion status after we swap the two. Notice that for all possible pairs, none of them swap their relative positions except for the pair involving A and B. That means that, besides the pair A and B, all other pairs don't have their inversion status changed at all. So the only change in the total number of inversions is from the pair A and B. And we are guaranteed to have a change here. If A and B were not an inversion, they are now. And if they were an inversion beforehand, they aren't anymore. So, the pair of A and B toggle their inversion status from the swap. So thus, as this is the only case where an inversion is created or destroyed, the number of inversions either goes up by 1 or down by 1, which is an odd amount. So that completes the adjacent swap case. So what about swaps in general? Well, we can construct a general swap from chaining a bunch of adjacent swaps. Suppose we wanted to swap 4 and 5 in the list 4, 3, 1, 5, 2. Then one way to do this is to use 3 adjacent swaps to move 4 to where 5 currently is, and then use 2 more swaps to move the 5 where the 4 originally was. Then, since each adjacent swap changes the total number of inversions by an odd amount, the 5 odd changes causes the overall swap between 4 and 5 to make the total number of inversions change by an odd amount. And this works in general. If I wanted to swap any two numbers A and B that are n apart, then it takes n adjacent swaps to move from A to B, and minus 1 adjacent swaps to move B to where A was, which means 2n minus 1 adjacent swaps will use total. So then an odd number of odd changes happens, which yields an odd change overall from the swap. So that completes the arbitrary swapping case. With that proved, we can now easily solve the problem. Counting the number of inversions at the start and at the end, we come up with 6 and 0. If we were to use an odd number of swaps, then since each swap changes the number of inversions by an odd amount, at the end of the process, the number of inversions overall should be odd. But to get from 6 to 0, we need the number of inversions to change by an even amount. So that makes this impossible. We can't change the number of inversions by an even amount using an odd number of swaps. Thus, we have proved that it is impossible to swap the numbers 4, 3, 1, 5, 2 into order with an odd number of swaps, completing the problem. The previous three problems were mostly theory and folklore problems, but now we're going to take a stab at a competition math proof problem, USAMTS 4-1-31. The problem statement is as follows. A group of 100 friends stand in a circle. Initially, one person has 2019 mangoes, and no one else has mangoes. The friends split the mangoes according to the following rules. Sharing. To share, a friend passes 2 mangoes to the left and 1 mango to the right. Eating. The mangoes must also be eaten and enjoyed. However, no friend wants to be selfish and eat too many mangoes. Every time a person eats a mango, they must also pass another mango to the right. A person may only share if they have at least 3 mangoes, and they may only eat if they have at least 2 mangoes. The friends continue sharing and eating, until so many mangoes have been eaten that no one is able to share or eat anymore. Show that there are exactly 8 people stuck with mangoes, which no longer can be shared or eaten. The crux of the problem is this weird process. At every step, we either have a person move 1 mango right and 2 mangoes left, or they eat a mango and move a mango right. And yet somehow, through this chaotic process, we always end up with 8 mangoes in the end. So how do we even start? With processes like these, where there's a lot of freedom, yet somehow we can still conclude something strong, that usually means there's an invariant at play which we can use. Let's first assign some variables. Let's let the person who starts with the 2019 Mingos be labeled person 0, and have it go person 1, person 2, person 3, as we head to the right, all the way up to person 99. Then, have MI denote how many Mingos the ith person has. So at the beginning, M0 is 2019, and M1 through M99 is 0. Then, to find an invariant, we want to find a quantity that does not change under the two choices of sharing or eating in terms of MI. Looking at the eating option, person I causes M sub I to go down by 2, and M sub I plus 1 to go up by 1. Somehow, we need to have the invariant expression remain the same after this. In a sense, a mango person I plus 1 has is worth twice as much as a mango person I has. This motivates considering the quantity m sub I plus 2 times m sub I plus 1. Subtracting 2 from m sub I and adding 1 to m sub I plus 1 leaves this expression the same. We want to weight m sub I plus 1 twice as much as m sub I. So then for a global invariant expression, consider the binary-like sum from I equals 0 to 99 of 2 to the I times m sub I. This works pretty well. If a person I eats, then as m sub I decreases by 2 and m sub I plus 1 increases by 1, the invariant decreases by 2 times 2 to the I, but increases by 2 to the I plus 1, which yields a net change of 0. However, there is one slight catch. That doesn't work so well with person 99, as if they eat, they decrease the invariant by 2 times 2 to the 99, but increase it by only 2 to the 0 times 1. So, there's a crazy net change of negative 2 to the 100 minus 1. We'll have to deal with that somehow, but before that, let's look at the sharing process under the invariant. The sharing process is such that if PI shares, then MI decreases by 3, MI minus 1 increases by 2, and MI plus 1 increases by 1. Then, we easily get that minus 3 times 2 to the I plus 2 times 2 to the I minus 1 plus 1 times 2 to the I plus 1 is equal to 0. So the invariant works perfectly for sharing as well. Except, of course, near the edges. Person 0 sharing yields an overall change of minus 3 times 2 to the 0 plus 2 times 2 to the 99 plus 1 times 2 to the 1st, which is 2 to the 100th minus 1. And person 99 sharing overall yields changes of minus 3 times 2 to the 99 plus 2 times 2 to the 98 plus 1 times 2 to the 0, which is minus 2 to the 100 minus 1. Our invariant is almost perfect. We only need to find a way to modify our invariant so it can deal with the changes of size 2 to the 100 minus 1. But wait! There's a very simple way to do that. Just consider the invariant sub, but mod 2 to the 100 minus 1. In other words, consider the remainder of the original invariant sum when divided by 2 to the 100 minus 1. Changes of the size 2 to the 100 minus 1 are equivalent to nothing, to 0 then. So now we have a true invariant, the sum from I equals 0 to 99 of 2 to the I times M sub I mod 2 to the 100 minus 1, is a quantity that does not change no matter who eats and no matter who shares. Now that we have this invariant, the rest is just finishing the proof with this knowledge. At the beginning of the process, we have that the invariant quantity is 2019 times 2 to the 0, which is 2019. At the very end of the process, we're told nobody can eat or share anymore, meaning that everyone has either 1 mango or 0 mangoes. Note that the final sum is between 0 and 2 to the 100 minus 1, since m sub I can be at most 1. Since the invariant at the start was 2019, at the end it's 2019 as well. Thus, the remainder of the sum mod 2 to the 100 minus 1 must be exactly 2019. Then by the size bounds I just mentioned, we get that the sum is exactly 2019. Then, since all the mi are either 0 or 1, this means m sub I represents 2019 in binary. 2019 in binary is 111111000011, meaning that people 0, 1, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10 all have one mango at the end, and nobody else has any mangoes, proving that there are exactly 8 mangoes left. Exactly what was desired. So that completes the proof. That concludes all the problems I wanted to explain regarding invariants. But if you found these solutions to be fun, I've prepared some problems you can try for yourself. The last two are much more difficult than the first three, and the very last one is one of my personal favorites. Hope you learned something from this video. If you enjoyed it, you can support it by liking, commenting, and subscribing, and if you want to see my previous works, they're on screen right now.